say was too certain for shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so
just everyone. Welcome to Lakeside. We're so glad you joined us today. It is Sweater Sunday. I hope you are wearing a sweater. We all are. And I also have jingle bell earrings because it's Christmas time. So we are going to sing a couple songs about angels because we're hearing about today the good news that the angels brought to the world. So sing it out with us.
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo, by your heavenly song. Gloria in excelsis Deo, gloria in excelsis. Whose birth the angels sing, come adore on bended knee, Christ the Lord, the newborn King. On earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful, O ye nations, rise, join the tribe of the skies. With angelic chorus proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. The God at sea, to give the second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Hey, welcome to Lakeside. I'm so glad that you've joined us here. My name is Pastor Steve, and we have gathered here online. And today, guess what day it is? It's what? It's Sweater Sunday. So I hope that you have joined us in your best holiday sweater. Maybe those in your home are dressed with you and you're gathered around a screen. We would love to see just kind of a picture of you. We terribly miss being together, especially on this Sunday where we kind of celebrate the spirit of Christmas through awesome sweaters. So take a picture of your crew at your house, your home, your apartment, wherever you're at, and joining us here today. Tag us on Instagram, tag us on Facebook. If you don't know how to do that, you can just like simply send that picture by email to office@lakesidecov.org, and there, Allie, she'll put together kind of a slideshow of all the awesome sweaters that you guys are repping right now. So welcome to Sweater Sunday. We're so glad that you've joined us here. As you've gathered here, that tells me something about the condition of your soul, that you're open to knowing God more, or you're wanting to go deeper in relationship with God. And so I know that God's going to meet us here in this space, that he can do something way beyond what we can do together. But as we're distanced behind these screens, I know that God is going to meet us here in this space today. We want to also say thank you for your generous support, your offerings, what you have sacrificed to continue to support the ministries and partner with us at Lakeside. That's incredible that God has been faithful in providing all that we've needed this year, even in the midst of this pandemic. And so we're going to invite you to consider that year-end offering, that gift, to continue to give us a strong momentum into the new year, into 2021. So you can give an offering in one of three ways. You can go online to our give page. You can text to give by 84321, and you just type in an amount, and the prompts will come up, and it's a safe and a secure way to do that. Or you can mail your offering into our P.O. box. But I'm just grateful for how we have come together as a community to continue to reach more people, even during this season that we have been separated and behind screens. So thank you for your faithfulness. And now also, as you prepare for what's coming up this week for their Christmas Eve service, it's going to be at 6:30. We're going to be coming live to you from the Chanhassen High School auditorium. We couldn't be more excited about what's coming together for that evening. And so during that time, we're going to invite you to kind of set the tone and create a different space in your home. Maybe you have an early dinner and you turn the lights down and you light some candles, whatever you might need to do in your home, that we could celebrate Christmas Eve together. And so maybe this is an opportunity for you to text a friend with the link to say, hey, I'd love for you to join us. Friends at this time of the year are way more open to receiving an invitation for you to join them online. And it might be their first step as they take a step closer to God in a relationship with Jesus Christ. So we encourage you to do that, and we can't wait for you to join with us. Also, at that service, we're going to be receiving an offering, a special offering that's going to support Covenant Pines Bible Camps in their scholarship fund. And so that scholarship fund will be absolutely important this coming summer, as there are barriers economically for more kids to be able to come to camp. And so here's a message from kids that have experienced the power of Covenant Pines, and check out their stories and what they have to say, what they love about Covenant Pines and how they have encountered God. So here are their stories now.
I like everything, especially the slide.
And I liked all the family time we got to spend together, and going off the dock and the giant water slide with the other moms.
I liked seeing my dad jump off the rope.
The best thing I like about Covenant Pines is meeting new friends and learning about Jesus and the whale ride.
What I like about Covenant Pines is the art shack and the floating dock, and I like the outdoors and playing camp games.
I love to be at Covenant Pines.
What I love about Covenant Pines is all the fun activities and family time I get to spend.
Some things I love about Covenant Pines are the big games. Two of my favorites are Capture the Duck and this water one in the big field.
I have so many fun memories as a kid at Covenant Pines. I loved chapel and all the awesome songs. And now as a mom, I love going there with my kids and making those special memories and that awesome place together. The activities are amazing, they're so much fun, and it's fun to watch my kids enjoy them too.
Family camp at Covenant Pines is a great way for us to spend time together as a family in the outdoors and to get to know several of the other families at Lakeside.
My favorite thing about camp is absolutely everything.
My favorite thing about camp is the chapel time and building relationships with everyone.
What I like about Covenant Pines is it's just a really fun environment. They really make you feel welcome and you always make such great friends.
What I love about Covenant Pines is I love the games and they keep you entertained so you're not bored and anything else like the Bible camp and the water stuff.
Now as we've gathered here, this is week 4 in Advent. And as we've been sharing with you, Advent is a season of preparation and of waiting. It's kind of like waiting to unwrap that gift that you know and you're hoping for that might bring joy and hope into your life. So here in Advent at Lakeside, we invite people to share with us a reading from their home. So let's go to their reading at this time.
Today we light the fourth candle of Advent and we wait for the gift that God brought down to us at Christmas.
Jesus said, I'm the light of the world.
Whoever follows me will have the light of life and will never walk in darkness.
Hear the words from the letter of 1 John 4. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us.
Today we light this candle to remind us that love has no bounds. In the midst of a time when we experience strict boundaries, God's love has no boundaries or barriers for those who open their hearts to his love, mercy, and forgiveness.
Please pray with me. God, we thank you for this gift of love that is found in Jesus. Remind us of his love in our lives and the good news for all the people that was announced at Christmas. Amen. Amen.
It's good to see people in their homes reading and sharing with us. It helps us feel a little bit more connected. Now, before we go into a time of greeting, we're going to bless and send our kids off to their Lakeside Kids resources. So kids, this is the last week in Ask Pastor Steve the questions in the video. So check out those resources and we'll be back together after a time of greeting.
May God give you eyes to see all that is good, all that is good. The courage for it. Give you ears to hear his loving voice.
Hey, Lakeside, I'm so glad that you guys have joined with me here online. I couldn't be more excited about what's coming up in just 3 days. In 3 days is Christmas Eve Eve, and maybe that kind of freaks you out because you know you only have about 3 or 4 days to get everything in order in your homes. But on Christmas Eve Eve at 6:30, we're going to be coming to you live from the Chanhassen High School Auditorium, and we're super excited about that. Though we're going to totally remember this year, 2020, and how this gathered us so differently. For Lakeside, this time of the year is one of my most favorite times that we've had coming together. But I've also heard stories about these at-home Christmas kits and how they've helped homes and families and people start new practices of prayer. There have been different activities that have helped helped you all engage in the Bible and reading a little bit more consistently. And even some of your efforts where you've told me that you have giggled like you have never giggled before, trying to drop off those starred gift bags on people's homes, ringing the doorbell, and running as fast as you can. But here's what I want you to know as we're coming up to that Christmas Eve service, that I want you in your homes to get ready. Make sure that everybody has a candle, LED, or a real candle, whatever it might be. But we're gonna end our time like we do with a moment of silent night. And what that means for you is you may need to just turn up the volume on your TV and sing with us. I know it's hard when you're at home to like sing aloud, and some of you aren't singers, but turn up your volume to like 10. Just crank it and join with us in that moment. So I wanted you to be prepared for that. It seems like it's gone so fast, but it was just 4 weeks ago that we began this message series, The Thrill of Hope. And we began in the book of Luke in chapter 1, which oftentimes when we enter into the Christmas story, that's not where you start. But that's where we began our series. And today we're getting to chapter 2, which is a little bit more familiar. It's what gave the fuel to the Charlie Brown Christmas special to have that long staying power, you know? It's that moment when Linus grabs his blanket and goes out and center stage in the spotlight. And I hope you're able to catch that last week when they aired it on PBS. But it's that story that we're going to enter into today. But when you think of all these Christmas specials, and maybe you've been binge watching some of them on Netflix or Amazon or Disney Plus, whatever you stream things on, it seems like these Christmas specials, we watch only like 1 month out of the year. I mean, it's not like I'm watching some of these Christmas specials in July, but we go to some of these because there's something that speaks to us in these Christmas specials, because we often find these characters, like the main characters, they're ordinary. They're uncommon, they're unsuspecting, they're unexpected, and they're doing something that's absolutely unordinary. Think of some of the movies that we watched during this time of year, and maybe you've watched some of these specials, or Christmas wouldn't be complete if you didn't gather around and watch that together. I mean, you've got Charlie Brown Christmas special, classic, one of my faves. You got Elf. Yeah, I'm sure there's some Elf fans. There's Home Alone. It's a Wonderful Life, The Grinch, and whatever version and you want to watch The Grinch in. I bet you guys have your favorites. You got Christmas Vacation, though not officially endorsed or sponsored by Lakeside, but it's out there. It's one of those Christmas classics. You got Jingle All the Way. If I haven't named your Christmas classic yet, would you right now in the chat name what your go-to, the one that you hit replay, that your Christmas season would not be complete if you didn't watch that Christmas classic? Share it with us in the chat. We would love to know what is your go-to, what's your jam for the Christmas specials. But here's the thing. If any of you right now type in Die Hard, the online host is just going to delete it, because that is not a Christmas special. Though it happened at Christmas time, Bruce Willis, Die Hard is not Christmas. So don't go there. I'm just going to veto that one. But here's what I mean. That I think that these Christmas specials, they draw on these characters who are uncommon, that are unexpected, that they end up doing these things that are absolutely unordinary. But I don't think that they're actually at all original. I mean, think about this. You have these people, these characters. You get Charlie Brown. He'll never be a varsity football letter earner. There's Buddy, an awkward grown-up wearing a green tights and guzzling syrup. You got Kevin from Home Alone, who's this precocious, smart-mouth kid who gets put in timeout and absolutely forgotten about. You have Eddie, you know, cousin Eddie, who sleeps in the RV out on the street. He ends up actually saving Christmas. And then there's the classic Christmas Rudolph. I mean, these are the characters that are uncommon. They're ordinary. The ones that are not going to be the heroes. But the Christmas special, Rudolph, it's kind of freaky. I don't know if you get that sense. I get this sense. It's kind of weird. It's odd. It's the old one where it's the toys that are cast off because they have no value. They're broken. They're discarded. The island of misfit toys. It seems like in all of these holiday classics, it's the misfits at the margins that seem to become extraordinary. But again, I don't know that these storylines are all that original. I don't think they're original at all. I think they're borrowing from even a better story, the real Christmas story. It's in the Christmas story that some of the main characters are the misfits at the margins. But there's good news in this story because it's God who uses them in powerful ways that should give you and it should give me hope that God can do the same in our lives. Maybe you felt like a misfit at the margins. And if you haven't, maybe you've been tempted to judge those who are. Why you are on the in and why they're on the out? So I'm going to invite you here today to turn with me to chapter 2 of Luke's gospel. And here we're going to pick up the story at verse 8. Now, I want to fill in some of the gaps if you're joining us and if today for the first time and you've missed the last couple of weeks. I want to fill in a few of the gaps. Mary and Joseph, they've had their lives absolutely interrupted and their future rewritten. It's these angelic announcements that Mary is going to bring this long-expected baby, the Messiah, the hoped-for, the longed-for, the awaited-for Messiah to come and save the people of Israel. The Christmas story tells us that God hears us, that God has a plan for us, and God is with us. But today, when we read this story, it's because of the Roman Empire led by Caesar Augustus, who wanted to know how many people he had in his empire. And the only reason you do that is because you want to know how much you can gain in taxes so that you can build your army and go gather some more people and expand your empire. It's kind of like having to travel back home to your hometown to be counted for a census on tax day. It's not a great day to be traveling, and they aren't excited about going back to their hometown. Mary and Joseph, they're approaching this city called Bethlehem, and they can't find any place to stay. It's booming. It's crowded. There's a lot of commotion. And you can only imagine the prayer that Mary is praying on her way to Bethlehem. God, not here. God, this has to wait. I'm not ready. Joseph has no idea what he's doing. God, I need my mom. Can we just... Not now. This is the prayer of Mary as she's journeying. And this is where we begin our story in verse 8. It says this, "And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night." Now we're gonna pause right there. The shepherds in this story are a big deal. They make up a significant part of the Christmas story. They get 12 whole verses devoted to them when even the father, Joseph, he only gets 7 like drive-by mentions. They're a big deal in this story, but they weren't a real big deal in their society. They lived at the margins of the city. They were the original misfits of Christmas. Shepherds were considered to be just one degree better than someone with leprosy. Opinions of shepherds were that they were dishonest and thieving. Though they were rough, they were dirty, they were smelling. They were the last stop on the train to nowhere. These are what shepherds were. I mean, you had to be unsuccessful at several things before becoming a shepherd. That was the qualification. That was the prerequisite. That was like your resume, that you were unsuccessful at several things. I mean, you didn't do well studying the Torah, going to the Bible school for a Jewish kid. You failed at your family trade, and even the generosity of maybe one of your family's friends that offered you a job, you failed at that too. I mean, no Jewish boy had their hopes, their targets set on becoming a shepherd. So why are they at the center of the Christmas story? We'll find out as we continue reading here, continuing with verse 9. "An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.' Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. This first invitation was a personal invitation to come see Jesus born in the stable. And it was first made to the misfits on the margins. So why start here? I believe that God wanted everyone to know that the good news was truly for everyone. This invitation was this vivid illustration and the demonstration of Jesus' mission. Jesus, when he would get older and he would go on to teach and to preach and invite people into this new kingdom that he would talk about, he said, "This is my mission and this is my vision for why I'm here." And he said that I have come to this earth to seek and to save the lost. Meaning that this good news is for everyone, and this is the mission of Jesus. But still, shepherds, I mean, God, he's really bad at PR. I mean, but in true form, God consistently uses people we ignore to reveal the way that love works. Scott Erickson is an artist. He's a painter, he's a graphic designer, but he's also an author. And recently, he's created this book called Honest Advent. And in it, there are these provocative art scenes that cause people to think more deeply in the story of God and how God comes near to be with us, especially during this season of Advent. It's in this recent book called Honest Advent that he talks about these messengers of God's love for all people and the challenges of receiving his announcement. Through this love that he has using unsuspecting, common, ordinary people. And so he's taken the sort of a modern translation of who the shepherds might be. And in one of his pieces of art, it's that of a modern messenger, a shepherd bringing this good news. But as we've described what a shepherd looks like, who is your modern day shepherd? Who is that in your world, in your life, the person that you may pass by every day on the way to work, who might be living at the margins? Who might be that modern day shepherd, unsuspecting, the unexpected, to bring to you a word from God? Scott Erickson, he offers this image. It's this image of an elderly woman working at Staples. The one that you mechanically interact with while hoping that she doesn't mess up the computer while trying to ring up your ballpoint pens, scotch tape, and computer paper. And this is what he writes as a reflection of this image for him, of this messenger that oftentimes we don't welcome. He said, "The giver of life hides revelation in the things we ignore, because it is the work of humbling ourselves and asking to have eyes to see and ears to hear that truly transform our hearts." Look at that image for just a moment. The giver of life hides revelation in the things we ignore. In the story there at Christmas, it took two different people to hear this angelic announcement that it was good news for all people. You see, that there was a transformation that needed to happen in the townspeople to hear the message of divine birth coming from the mouths of failed religious school shepherds. Imagine them rapping on their door, excitement in their voice, in a story that is unimaginable. The townspeople needed to be transformed to understand this news that it was good for all people, not just for them, but the person who's delivering it. The second person that needed to be transformed were the shepherds, to believe that they had been invited to be preachers of a divine birth to their familiar neighbors, that they received something because they were seen, they were valued, that they were loved, that they were chosen, that they were welcomed and invited to be a part of this bigger story. But this was all very unexpected, beginning with the unsuspecting people that God invited to be his messengers. Now, when we think of this story, sometimes we might feel as though we live like shepherds. And other times we believe that we're the townspeople. The story shatters our expectations of who God loves, who God uses, who God works with and through and calls and invites to be a part of something bigger. The news of this great joy is for all people, but sometimes we can feel like we aren't worthy. We can feel like we aren't welcomed. The dirt, the stain of our past, our failures cannot be washed. We often can feel like shepherds. But this is good news that God's love is for all people. So if you feel like a shepherd today, maybe that is the word you need to hear today, that you're invited, that you're loved, that you're known, that you're seen to be a part of something bigger. But at other times, we look at others and believe that we are worthy. We should be the one that's selected and invited to do such things, that our hearts aren't transformed because we believe that this good news isn't really for all people, but it's good for me. There are days, honestly, that I live sometimes like a shepherd. And there are days that sometimes I live like the townspeople, that I'm deserving, and it's the people at the margins, it's their fault. They have to do something to earn it. There are times when we vacillate between both groups, but in this story, God says this is good news for all people. And the question for you is, do you believe that this is good news for all people? For you, for your neighbor, for the person who speaks a different language, for the person who serves you at the restaurant or checks you out at the grocery store? That's where I love that image that Scott Erickson gave. And here's this angelic announcement to the person simply serving in our community, checking you out at Staples. Maybe that changes the conversation that you might have with that person. A quick story. My family went to a grocery store, and they were greeted by just the most lovely person. And this person just gave my wife and my kids just joy, and then presented a request, or it was an invitation for us to meet a need. And we were blessed by this person's joy, this person's faith, and it gave us an opportunity to go find something that she had just mentioned in passing, to say, wow, we are all one and the same. We aren't on the inside, and this woman wasn't on the margins. But this is good news for all people. And so my family, they went out and they shopped for that one item, and they brought it back and put it back on the conveyor belt and dropped it on there. An item obviously not sold at that grocery store. And then it went down the conveyor belt. She looked at it and looked up at my family, and just with a big smile and a sense of joy, and it started a conversation. Because this is good news that is for all people. When we begin to live like this, people will begin to know this story more and more. God's going to invite you to live this out this week, that this is good news for all people. And if you're feeling right now that you're at the margins, this is God's invitation for you to step out of that space and into the center of God's love, because it's God's love that was sent to us at Christmas time to welcome you into a relationship with Jesus. And maybe today is your first step to take a step closer to God in that new reality, believing in God's love through Jesus, his death and his resurrection, his sacrifice. But it's this gift of moving from the margins into the center of God's love, because that's how God sees you. I'd love to pray for us in this moment. And we can't be more excited about coming back together to celebrate on Christmas Eve, this gift that comes to us, that God hears us, God is with us, that God speaks to us. He has a plan for us, and his presence with us is all that we need. And his love in this gift, in this message, is for all people. Let's pray. God, we give you thanks for this time and the space that we have come together. God, move us in ways that we would be transformed. Just as the shepherds were transformed and the people hearing this good news were transformed, that this news is for all people. God, move us into the center, that we would believe this, that we would live this, that we would welcome and invite other people to know this as well. But God, in our week this week, would you give us opportunities to love people like you loved us first? And so God, we thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy, and the gift that you give to us here at Christmas. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray all things. Amen.
Oh, come, Emmanuel.
As we've come out of a time of worship here today, being blessed by music and by readings and by what God has been speaking to you, knowing that this is good news for everyone, that this is the story of Christmas, I want to leave you with our blessing, that you are created by God, known, loved, and belong. Upon you rests the grace of God. Now may the deep peace of Christ be with you, the strong arms of God sustain you, and the power of the Holy Spirit strengthen you in every way. Amen, and God bless you, and we'll see you on Christmas Eve Eve.
Behold the star of Bethlehem, the word of God has become flesh unto us. A child is born, the Savior of this broken world. Oh, hear the angel voices sing, come, let us adore Him. Peace has come, for our King is with us. Oh, praise belongs to Christ alone.